Hey, welcome back to The Dive. The market's response to the Omnicron variant, Fed Chair Powell's pivot on inflation, the market's biggest risk, the outlook for commodities, and exchange-traded products are just a few of the topics our guest will deep dive into today. He is the founder and CEO of GraniteShares. Will Rhind is joining us today. But before we bring Will on, just a quick reminder to smash that subscribe button for me, please. Hey, Will, welcome back to The Dive.
Thank you. Great to be back.
Yeah, it's so great to have you back. Okay, so let's begin here. U.S. Treasury yields dropped as concerns over the Omicron COVID variant continued to weigh on stock markets. What do you think are the safe haven assets right now?
Well, I think the last few days, what we've seen is in this particular volatility, you know, two assets really spring to mind. Treasury themselves, so the shorter dated treasuries, certainly something that traditionally have acted as a safe haven in times of volatility, and that's really been no different this time around. The other one is gold. You know, gold has performed very well over the last few days of volatility, but the drop we saw on the Friday last week after Thanksgiving, and then earlier on this week. So I think gold is being, you know, very resilient, or has performed very resiliently against this volatility so far.
Definitely. Okay, so let's move on here. Federal Reserve Chairman Jerome Powell said this week, and I quote, "The recent rise in COVID-19 cases and the emergence of the Omicron variant pose downside risk to employment and economic activity and increased uncertainty for inflation," end quote. Which leads us to this question. What do you think are the factors pushing inflation upward?
Well, probably the two main factors are the rise in commodity prices themselves, which is partly due to supply chain issues around the world, again, resulting from COVID lockdowns and such that we saw last year. And then it's also partly due on the commodity side to lack of investment in commodity production, you know, over the last few years. And the chickens have come home to roost, so to speak. And, you know, we're in an environment where the economy is opening up, and we have these supply chain issues that are still a hangover from COVID. Plus, we're also meeting, you know, very, very difficult production, or the ability to increase production because of this lack of investment in the space. Now, on top of that, we're seeing wage inflation as well. So wages are actually rising as competition for workers heats up within the economy as well. And we're seeing, you know, record amounts of people kind of being hired, but also wage rises across the board, whether you're, you know, a minimum wage worker or whether you're a sort of so-called white collar worker, you know, at a major corporation, that wages seem to be on the march across the board.
So what do you think the biggest risk is in the market if the inflation issue does not stop?
Well, the biggest risk is always the same risk that is kind of top of mind when we talk about inflation, which is, at the end of the day, those inflationary pressures just can't be absorbed anymore by either corporations or ultimately by consumers. And that will impact companies' profits and companies' earnings. And at that point, you see stock prices fall and a recession, you know, most likely being the outcome. So, you know, that's what inflation does. It's a sort of a quiet tax, if you will. And it's bearable to some level, but at some point, you know, the price rises become too much for people to bear, and it creates demand destruction.
Okay, so oil plunged around 12% last week. With the demand outlook under a cloud, do you think OPEC will lean towards pausing output hikes? And what effect do you think this would have on oil prices?
I think this is an interesting one, because I'd sort of maybe slightly clarify the demand outlook by saying that the demand outlook is actually, in my opinion, very robust, with the exception of probably one thing, probably the only thing that can derail prices. And we saw that last week and beginning of this week, which is any kind of COVID reemergence. In other words, the possibilities of lockdowns and or just reduced travel, either through fear or through, you know, government mandates, et cetera. So I think really at this stage, in my mind, that's kind of really the only thing I see as being a risk, downside risk, mm-hmm. to the oil price. I mean, bear in mind that we have a situation where, you know, oil got to $80 plus in a world which is not fully reopened. So, you know, China, for all intents and purposes, is still closed. A lot of Asian countries still closed effectively. So we're not in a situation where we are operating as a global economy on a business as usual kind of perspective. So if we were to fully open, you know, a la 2019, for example, I think we could see oil prices materially higher from here. So in my mind, that's really the only risk at this stage is something like COVID in terms of creating that demand destruction.
How do you see commodity prices and the overall economy linked? From the large macro USA perspective, the Federal Reserve is tapering bond buying and looking to raise interest rates. How do you see this impacting prices and commodities?
Well, I think, again, it comes back to the fundamentals that you have a situation where we've had years of underinvestment in production, whether we're talking about energy production, whether we're talking about metals, but commodity prices and commodity production across the board really has been a lack of investment in the space because prices have been subdued, you know, for a number of years now. And so this is kind of meeting this perfect storm of increased demand coming from the global economy reopening, but the supply constraints that are in place, still in place in the global economy. So, you know, the outlook for me, the short term is very positive because of the reasons I just explained. But I think longer term, for a lot of the commodity complex, it's going to be very positive because we are undergoing a energy transition from a world where the majority of our energy, and even last year, was still consumed. You know, 84% of the world's energy needs comes from fossil fuels, but we're transitioning away from that. And over the next sort of decade, a couple of decades, we're transitioning away from, you know, fossil fuels. Now, we may never get to a place where that's entirely at zero, but my point is that the new technologies that will be needed to create those new energy, there's energy systems and energy infrastructure require commodities, albeit different commodities than say oil and natural gas, but will be metals, rare earths, et cetera. And I think for those commodities, the future is very bright.
So over the past few months, GraniteShares launched leveraged ETPs on French large cap stocks. What interests you about the French market?
Well, it's one of the two largest ETP markets in Europe. So we were already in the UK. And so we started there actually, just funnily enough, just before COVID hit. And so we launched our business in the UK. We weren't able to really do much in last year because of COVID. But as things started to ease up, we started to expand our business in Europe. And so we expanded into the French market, launching a series of products on Euronext Paris. And so in Europe, the market is still international, but with a very strong domestic bias still. In other words, you know, if you're a French investor, you're still going to be buying predominantly local or domestic assets, so investing in domestic stocks. Even though clearly there's an international appeal for US stocks or US exposure and other international exposures. So you have to offer the local or some local exposure as well as international.
GraniteShares has created single stock exchange traded products that may be used to leverage long and short positions in Tesla, NIO, and Volkswagen, three of the world's largest electric vehicle manufacturers. Why did they choose them out of all the EV companies?
Well, I think you kind of just touched on it there, is that they're among the largest, if not the largest, players in the space. So, you know, first of all, with Tesla and NIO, they're pure play. So in other words, they just do electric vehicles. And from that perspective, it's I know there are now some other companies that do that. Rivian obviously just IPO'd recently in the last few weeks, which is a big one in terms of big market caps. So we'll have to see, you know, really how that transpires. Maybe that's something that we look at. But Volkswagen, I think they've made that formal commitment that they're going, you know, all electric, you know, over the next sort of decade or so. Plus, because our business is in Europe, that's a huge European company. That's a company that everybody in Europe knows. Clearly, everybody knows who Tesla is. NIO, perhaps a little bit less so. But they're just, I think, names that people are really, really interested in at the moment. We've seen a huge amount of trading volume in them because it's really it's captured the sort of the trading zeitgeist of the moment, which is electric vehicles. And, you know, we don't have cryptocurrency, but cryptocurrency as well would be another one.
Mm-hmm, definitely. All right. Well, thank you so much for joining us today, Will, and sharing your thoughts with us again. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me. Look forward to seeing you soon.
Thanks so much for tuning in today. We'll be back again tomorrow, so be sure to turn that notification bell on and smash that subscribe button.